Von einem alten Bekannten, der schon zum 32C3 und zum 33C3.
We're about to hear a talk from one of our old friends who took us to a fabulous world of unsafe devices and insecure connections and our trust in them, even the past 2 years. He's a PhD student at the University of Erlangen-Nürnberg.
He's
doing a PhD in information science and computer science, and he is going to present to us the fabulous world of mobile banking. Please welcome to the stage Vincent Haupert.
Ja, herzlichen Dank für die Einführung.
Thank you for the introduction. Fabulous is a very many-layered word. First of all, I would like to thank the fabulous cooperation with my colleague. Thank you very much.
Ja, online banking.
Online banking, I assume most of you are using it. It's used the PIN-TAN modus operandi for years.
Sorry. Okay, also seit jeher im PIN-TAN-Verfahren. Und ja, also erster Faktor ist irgendwie immer, man loggt sich
online. The first factor is always logging into the online banking portal with your username and password. And after that, you start a transaction with an IBAN and an amount. And then you have to enter a transaction number to authorize that transaction that's been there for ages. And the way of generating, receiving that TAN can differ quite a bit. The first methods, in the first three methods in this list have were motivated by the fact that there was quite a lot of fraud, and chip TAN was the zenith of what can be achieved technically, in, at least as far as security is concerned, and therefore photo TAN and app TAN try to optimize a bit more for usability, which is not a bad idea. And I don't have anything against these as long as you use two devices, because if you use, whenever you use two devices, you have the protection of knowing that if one of your devices is compromised, the transaction is still secure. 2 years ago, I was asked about PhotoTAN and said that it's a fairly reliable method because it implicitly assumes that you use two devices because you have to scan a second device and then it generates a TAN. Then there's PushTAN or methods that are implemented in two apps. This has been around for ages, and the paradox thing is that these days you can even use PhotoTAN on the same device. There's nothing to scan anymore, the apps just communicate amongst themselves, which shows how absurd all this is. But nobody's really talking about two app methods anymore. Most try to implement a one-app method. This is remarkable because the SMS-TAN method has undergone the transformation to from a one single-purpose device to a multi-purpose device, and which means that now it's more or less another app. But this meant that people were using the same device to initiate and authorize a transaction, and this turned out to be a bad idea fairly quickly and was excluded from many banks'
frage ich mich natürlich,
terms and conditions quite quickly.
Also hier wird ja auch alles auf einem Gerät gemacht,
but und das habe ich vor 2 Jahren dann auch gezeigt. This makes me wonder what the difference is with the other one app methods.
Das hat hingegen die Sparkasse nicht so richtig beeindruckt.
So this didn't really impress the Sparkasse, ja, German Bank.
Waren eigentlich alles nur Laborbedingungen, das geht in Wirklichkeit gar nicht.
And und es funktioniert they already said, yeah, there's a lot of prerequisitions and this won't really work.
Jedes Mal, wenn wir eine neue Version rausbringen, ist ein hoher individueller und manueller Aufwand.
There's a lot of work involved in rolling out a new version of the software, and that's what they want to address.
So, jetzt habe ich ja vorhin gesagt, so bei SMS-TAN hat man gesagt, ja,
das machen wir nicht. Ne? Yeah, SMS-TAN, we don't do that, that's not safe. So, what's really the difference with these apps?
Aber ich denke, wichtig,
yeah, there's a lot of properties, but the important part is the verification by a third party. There's a quite a big market of third party vendors that sell you verification and safety for these kind of things. There's a small selection here on the slide.
Ist Promon.
The one that I'm going to look at is Promon.
So, Promon hat das Produkt
Promon has a product called Shield.
Und, das ist die Informationen, die hier stehen, sind allesamt von der Webseite.
All of these these pieces of information on this slide are from their web page, and it's supposed to shield your app from unsafe environments. It's platform independent, it works on iOS, Windows, on Android, and it should be usable within minutes. The next quote is from a video. It recognizes every danger or
threat
in real time,
and
it becomes highly secure even on infested and compromised systems.
Schauen wir uns das mal genauer an.
So, let's look at this some more.
Was sind eigentlich so für Eigenschaften, die diese
Properties or features?
Also das sind jetzt so zwei Sparten. Da gibt es diesen klassischen App-Härtungsbereich.
There's two categories. There's the app hardening that does verification analysis, and there's the new area called best practices, like certificate pinning, their own keyboard and so on, stuff the developer usually did. So they're all trying to do this right now. And in the space of mobile banking, they're pretty important. So how do you use this shield now? How do I want to use this for my Android or iOS app? Do I, as a user, still have to make some changes in my settings? Or do I need to turn off features or like root detection? Or
this
Promon tool, this shield, just show up and then magically make my app safe, or how does it work? This is the list of the apps, 31 of them, that actually all use Promon Shield. The two that I just grayed out, those are not banking apps. They're coming from the finance space, but they're not banking apps, which I want to focus on. So now I want to look at the German ones, so we can exclude a few more. So we can see already that still a large number of their customers are German. All of those are German banks that a lot of you may know. There's also, they're quite important.
Banking apps.
And let's look at one specifically. It's called Yomo. Maybe not a lot of you know it, but why is it special?
Yomo is eigentlich erstmal ein App.
Yomo is a one-app verification system. As I already said, this is not special anymore. Everybody does it. But it's...
Es gibt, also ich höre immer wieder das Gerücht, dass es intern sogar ein
App 27 hieß. A rumor that it was called App 27. Because apparently there was an app called 26 that was the inspiration for this. And it uses the latest version of Promon Shield because it is a very new app. And I assume that basically because it's new, they always take the latest one.
Dann schon die neueste Version verwenden, wenn sie jetzt sagen, wir machen auch so ein App-Authentifizierungssystem. Gut. Jetzt, wie funktioniert denn das jetzt intern, wenn man jetzt mal ein bisschen technischer
wird? How does this work under the hood? Promon's integration tool comes along and it takes the main activities, so the entry point of the app, and embeds a native library, the libshield function. They also introduce some Java classes because they have to load their own library, they need some glue code, and well, this is obfuscated, but that's not very important right now. But in addition to the actual app, all the strings and constants are taken out of the app and are imported into their app. And this includes certificates. These are no longer handled by the actual app. It's called by the Shield app.
Dann modifizieren wir halt mal diese Library, diese Native.
So if we want to get rid of this, the first thing you might try to do is to
das ein Control Flow Graph, also ist nicht Windows abgestürzt oder sowas.
Get rid of that library, and this is a Control Flow Graph. This is not a Windows crash. This is an actual graph, and you don't really want to look at it. There are some approaches to hacking this. It uses a fairly common obfuscator, but it's economically not feasible. We want something simple.
Ja gut, nächster Ansatz ist dann, ja, wenn wir
the next approach
können, ja, dann
would be, if we can't modify it, then we just have to strip the library out of the app. But it's not quite as simple as that, because all the strings and the constants and the client certificates are in this libshield function, so we have to first strip those out.
Und fangen wir mal an mit den Strings. Wie schaut's
Let's
da
start
aus?
With the strings.
Also jetzt ist da einmal dargestellt, links ist Yomo.
On the left side you see Yomo and on the right side you see the Libshield function by Promon.
Bevor man irgendwie Promon verwendet hat, unten ist dann
it's a before and after setup essentially.
Es ist dann halt so, wenn da jetzt einfach ein String ausgegeben werden soll, wie Yomo.
So if you want to output a string like Yomo,
native library,
then they replace it with a call to their native library and it's got some mappings internally and returns a string. It's not difficult. It makes sense. So if you want to circumvent this, what can you do? Let's find out what the highest index in this thing is, and then we iterate from 0 to n and create our own mapping, and then we can reverse what they've done in their library. But it turned out we didn't even have to do that work because you can just keep iterating until it returns null. Constants are a similar problem. Top of this we have a constant that turns out to be -1, and after Promon ran over it, it just is some random garbage that doesn't really make sense. But what Promon does is that it uses it implements something on top of that. It uses reflection that then converts this back into the correct constant before it's accessed for the first time. The solution to this is fairly similar. You just enter all the classes that call this function and you call it yourself, and you've got your own mapping. Client certificate. This is getting more tricky.
Man kann jetzt nicht mehr genau so vorgehen wie gerade eben.
Because you can't use the same approach as previously, because Yomo turns its own Java code into a request, but doesn't pass it to Android's library. Instead, it passes it to Promon, and they do some work on that, and then they add their own certificate. And of course, you can't just ask Promon to give it their client certificate, but it has to be somewhere in memory. You have to be able to find it somehow. We assumed that we'd only be able to find the certificate, but what we actually found was a far more interesting data structure. This looks a bit confusing, but these are configuration files. Here we have what we were looking for. It's the client certificate in base 64.
Ja, jetzt können wir loslegen. Ja. Also, was machen wir?
Jetzt können wir das
eigene Tool NoMob verwenden, um diesen ganzen Prozess von Promon wieder rückgängig zu machen.
So we'll write our own tool, NoMob.
Dann haben wir diese Promon-geschützte App. Im nächsten Schritt müssen wir irgendwie unseren Analyzer
let us download the app from the Play Store. Then we need to analyze the app that was run through Promon Shield. It will extract all the mappings for us. This means we need to install it on a device. And as soon as the app starts, all these mappings fall out and the configuration file along with the client certificate as well.
Then
we feed this into our tool, and out comes the unprotected app.
Ja, der ganze Prozess,
yeah, also so the whole process from start downloading the app, installing it, and
dauert so 5 bis 10 Minuten.
Getting the final result takes 10 to 15 minutes. Depends on how big the app is.
Dauert nicht so lang.
If it's 10 megabytes, then it's fast. If it's 100 MB,
dann dauert es halt entsprechend ein bisschen länger, weil wir da irgendwie Transformationen auf Basis von DexLib 2 machen müssen und dann dauert es.
You have to do a lot of transformation on the basis of DexLib 2, but
laden wir direkt
whatever. After a little time, you get your result.
Ja, jetzt schauen wir aber trotzdem nochmal auf diese Mappings, auf diese
Konfiguration. Let's look at those mappings some more. The configuration file that we just looked at before. It's pretty remarkable.
Diese ganzen Strings und Konstanten,
all those strings and constants, all of them are in that libshield.so.
But
we saw the configuration file, so why would they already be in the SO file?
Also stellt sich raus, diese
turns out that this libshield
SO
is already compiled by the vendor, and they actually deliver it like that to the app author. So it's already pre-compiled.
And
this IDE, this integration tool that they sell, already has that libshield that is all pre-compiled within it. And they're responsible for encrypting those files and the certificate,
and
they're already contained within the SO file. They're just being loaded and then used.
Und das macht jetzt eigentlich nochmal ein ganz anderes Angriffsszenario.
So that makes it even more interesting, because now we have a completely new attack vector. So if you look at this on the left,
Exit und Debugger URL.
You
okay,
see
a
couple of URLs, debugger URL.
Soll ich dann die App crashen? Und wenn ich sie crash, soll diese URL hier öffnen? Ja, und das ist bei den anderen Sachen relativ analog.
What this basically says is, it checks the app. If it's if it crashes, then it tries to use this URL and just opens it in the browser. So now, if we can modify it before it's being parsed, then
also zu dem Zeitpunkt
let's see what we can achieve.
Weil das andere war,
I was already being annoyed by this, because that was already pretty bad, and this, yeah.
Ja, genau. Also das hat sich jetzt bisher alles, was sehr iOS,
okay.
Android spezifisch.
So all of this was pretty Android specific. So let's have a look at the Promon Shield iOS.
Da gibt's auch eine
iOS is pretty much the same. There's also a config file.
Weniger umfangreich,
it's a lot less comprehensive. I already have the feeling that it's a lot less. There's a lot less work being done on it. But it's overall it's reasonably similar. It's just less sophisticated.
Wir schreiben das halt um.
Just a small rewrite.
Jetzt fassen wir nochmal die Angriffe zusammen.
Okay, so let's summarize the attack vectors. We just saw a couple. The first one that is a little bit more complicated, where you basically try to remove the Promon Shield, and the one that I just showed, where you just rewrite the config and you don't have any trouble at all, because there's no compatibility issues and so on. It just works.
So, danach.
So, after that, the app is completely unsecure.
die ganzen Hersteller implementieren in großem Stil auch keinen Repackaging-Schutz.
There is no repackaging protection being done by the app office, so we can just start automating it some more.
Erweitern wir doch NoMob mal so, dass wir das
automatisch machen, so that we can do it completely automated.
Und dann hier jetzt mal als Beispiel, das ist die VR Banking
App. So this is an example that I want to show. It's the VR Banking App. VR is a German bank.
Man will ja bestimmte Views, Text Views oder sowas manipulieren.
You want to manipulate a couple of text views. Those are the interesting ones.
Okay, Name des Empfängers ist jetzt hier.
It's the name of the recipient, but this is wrong. I actually want to change the IBAN. And the other one is the amount that is being transferred.
And
those you have to manually find out, and the rest you can do automated. You can inject everything. All you need to do is what you need to read out first.
Eine kleine Demo.
So let's do a demo.
Jetzt kann sich aber mal wieder Yomo zurücklegen. Also brauchen jetzt keine Angst haben. Geht nicht mit Ihnen weiter.
But, we're not going to use Yomo for this. They can relax. We are going to use the VR banks in the German VR bank.
Ist etwas zügig entstanden.
We took this video this afternoon, so it it was cobbled together a bit hastily. So here's what's about to happen. We have a Nexus device with a patch level from about, it lags behind about 1 year.
Wo man Dateien schreiben darf, die man eigentlich nicht schreiben darf. Also Dirty
we were looking for something that would let us write files that we would not usually be allowed to write.
Im Sinne von Supersuch zu bekommen. Ich glaube, das ist erst vor kurzem.
And it's not that simple to actually achieve full root on this device. But we can write files that we wouldn't normally be able to write.
Leute es geschafft haben, sowas zu platzieren.
So we are going to download an app from the actual Play Store.
And
our app just replaces it with a transaction that was with an app that was replaced through with an app that was run through NoMob. And it's going to try to manipulate the amount that is being transferred, and it's completely automated. All we had to do was determine the IDs.
Damit man kurz die Version sieht.
This is just to show you the version of the app.
Machen wir jetzt erstmal die VR Banking App auf.
And first we'll start the VR Banking App.
Damit man keine Aufnahmen machen kann.
And the screen is black because it has got the secure flag set, so that we can't record the screen.
Aus dem Play Store runter und ja, das ist echt.
So now we're downloading it from the Play Store, and yes, this is real. This is.
Das ist quasi eine scheinbar gute App und jetzt
appears to be a great app, but in the background my phone has been exploited. So let's restart the banking app.
So. Genau, jetzt muss man sich da eben einloggen. Jetzt machen wir die Transaktion.
Login. Let's start the transaction.
Und geht diesmal an mich.
And this time it's going to me.
Genau, noch kurz die IBAN eingeben.
Just have to enter my IBAN.
So, eben die 15 Euro, die ich gerade eben gesagt habe.
15 Euros, as I said.
Ist aber nicht so wichtig jetzt in dem Fall.
The subject of 34C3.
Jetzt ist die Überweisung versendet worden. Das bedeutet jetzt im nächsten
Schritt. The transfer has been sent, so the next step is
die Transaktion in der TAN App, in der Secure Go App.
Authorizing the transaction in the TAN App.
Auch wieder irgendwas gemacht.
And some things happened to this as well.
Auch wieder das Passwort eingeben.
I have to enter my password again.
Und dann im nächsten Schritt. Also wichtig ist jetzt natürlich hier, dass die IBAN stimmt. Es geht aber so schnell, da versichere ich euch, dass das stimmt. Da stehen noch 15 Euro immer noch.
I can assure you that the IBAN is the same and it still says 15 Euros.
Also geben wir die Transaktion frei.
And all seems correct, so we'll authorize the transaction.
So, genau, da unten steht auch irgendwie 15 Euro.
And
passt ja alles.
It says 15 Euros here as well, so all seems fine.
Wenn man reinschaut, dann waren es aber wirklich 1,23 Euro.
But if you look at this, it actually turned out to be just 1,23
Euro. Was hier wichtig ist,
the important thing here
dass das vollautomatisch war.
Is
das war nicht,
that all of this was completely automated.
Sondern man musste im Prinzip ja nur die IDs bestimmen, nachdem Promon draußen war und dann
after Promon was out, we just had to determine the IDs.
Die Reaktionen der beteiligten Parteien anschauen.
So, und yeah, the, let's have a look at the reactions of the parties involved.
Ende November, also gut einen Monat,
we've been in touch with Promon since the end of November. They've been very nice and professional.
Auch eine neue Version des
and they've developed a new version of Promon Shield. They've sent it to me, but I haven't been able to look at it more closely. But my NoMob app doesn't work. That is that I know. I don't know what kind of how much work it would be to get it to work again.
But
the point I'm trying to make is that we need more individualization from the apps because Promon Shield works the same on all these 31 apps. Because it's such a universal approach, I can just extract the config files each time.
Bis heute keine Schadensfälle bekannt.
And
merkwürdiges Verständnis von IT-Sicherheit.
As far as the banks, banks are concerned, I'm hearing the same thing from them for years. They haven't been told about any attacks.
Also 5-8% hat letztes Jahr eine Studie ergeben, sind diese app-basierten TAN-Verfahren.
And these app-based TAN methods have just a market share of 5-8%, so they are simply not very relevant, but this may change in the future.
I
really like this quote. It's by Dennis Kugler and Jens Bender. In the area of the transaction space, there's a special creativity that's being developed in the interpretation of the property two-factor authentication. I can only agree. So after mobile banking with one app, it doesn't get any worse. But then on Windows even, there is a one app authentication system now. So two questions. Is app hardening even sensible at all? Is there any point to it?
Or haben die überhaupt eine Daseinsberechtigung?
Is there, yeah.
Natürlich haben die eine Daseinsberechtigung.
My answer is yes, of course. It's sensible to have an additional layer of protection, but it needs to be on top. Is it a replacement for sensible two-factor authentication? The answer, of course, is no. Just like I said, because there are only software measures that are being taken,
and
they just can't prevent someone exploiting it. Thanks a lot.
Vielen Dank, Vincent, für deinen Talk und deine, einen weiteren Ausflug in die Welt des Mobile Bankings. Wir haben Zeit für einige Fragen. Also, wenn ihr Fragen habt, reiht euch an den Mikrofonen auf. Hier gibt es
time for questions and answers now. If you have any questions, line up next to the microphones.
Und dann können wir noch ein paar Fragen, oder Vincent kann ein paar Fragen für euch beantworten.
Vincent will be able to answer some of your questions.
Ihr könnt euch winken, wenn ihr an einem steht. Okay, an Mikrofon 3 haben wir eine Frage.
Ja, genau. Vielen Dank für den Talk. Ganz toll.
Thank you for your talk.
Jetzt gibt's ja für DRM-Systeme schon Dinge wie
Whiteline, die Trustzones have.
Hast du bei einer
Whiteline that use Trustzone directly in the ship. Have you seen anything about this in your research?
Das ist ein wichtiger Punkt und ich glaube eigentlich auch, dass Trustzone.
And I actually believe that trusted execution environments are a good method to securely do this on one device. In parallel, there's the Bootstomp talk that those guys will probably say I'm wrong, but that is an Ansatz that you can actually work on. I haven't seen it in detail, but the problem really is that there is no unified solution. There are a few proprietary solutions and there's no standard, so it's a bit hard to tell.
Waren die untersuchten Apps alle schon nach der PSD2?
Were the apps that you looked at
darauf das Zitat von den BSI-Leuten
approved due to the newest guidelines because those explicitly require two-factor authentication.
A strong two-factor authentication.
The standards have just been ratified, so there is a lot of time left for the banks to change their apps. Yeah, all the ads by the third-party vendors, they're already making claims that they support it, but it's a little difficult to say because the last decision that was taken in that regard sounded more like status quo, but it sounded to me like you need a secure display and then a method of not preventing copying. And if you ask the banks, of course they're going to say, yeah, we're conform to the PSD2 standard.
Does the internet have any questions?
Das scheint nicht der Fall zu sein. Ich habe noch eine Frage beim Proton 2.
Hast du dir außer Promon noch andere Bibliotheken
angesehen? Have you looked at any libraries apart from Promon?
Das liegt aber einfach auf. No, I have not. Es gibt ein paar andere, die im Markt auch noch verbreitet sind. There's a few more that are popular in the German space. For example, Axon. There's also something called Kobil.
Also nichts genaueres dazu sagen.
I can't say anything about those. I haven't looked at them. I don't have a problem with Promon at all. To be fair, but it's more of the exposure they have, because they're so big in the German market.
And
that was why it was worth it for me to look at it. If everybody had a different one, then yeah, sure, that would be a lot more effort. Then you would have to look at all of them. Whereas here, you can basically deactivate it once, and then it works everywhere.
So, Mikrofon 1, letzte Frage.
Vielen Dank für den Vortrag. Eine Frage zu dem Angriffsvektor.
I was wondering about the attack vectors. In your case, you simply replaced the app and made it easy to attack.
But would it be dran eine Application hat, die das dann einfach
would it be conceivable to have apps that simply replace them on the fly and just have you looked at that?
Well, that's what we're doing. I mean, we basically inject a component into that app, and I think your approach will work as well, but the replacement of an app is basically the easiest thing to do.
If it weren't rooted, then you probably would not be able to access one app from another app. So you need root or are there any other approaches?
Well, there's a bit of a vagueness with what is a root exploit, what is a rooted device. I mean, for me, basically, this is my own determination and I can use Dirty Cow, but it's not persistent. It's not like you can... It's hard to trace this, even if you ask the forensic expert.
Whereas here,
you can place your code there once, and then afterwards, everything is new. All of these root protections are basically pointless. So, let's have a round of applause again.